Matadlin, who's at knocking, is directorial assistant, and did all kinds of driving around and helping him with camera, moving it, and anything that was done in those days, you had to do, because this was not exactly a production of big budgets and stuff like that. We're talking about pennies. I grew up in Baghdad, and my father sent me here when I was 17, 18 actually. I told my father I wanted to go to America to study, and so what are you going to study? I said, what do you want me to do, study? You're paying for it. He said, economics. I didn't even know there was such a thing as a film studies. You got a degree for film? So I decided to go into film. I met Marty when we were both students at New York University. The first time I met Marty was in one of the sophomore classes. And then we started writing a lot of things together. And then when he started working on his graduate project, it started to be Who's That Knocking, which was called, various titles over the years. And the first title, I think, was Bring On the Dancing Girls. And this would be 65.
Well, I can't go first. Nobody's going first.
What do you mean?
Harvey came in as one of those actors who answer a call you put in magazines, newspapers that ask for actors to work on student projects. And Marty was impressed by him. Everybody was. And he was cast as J.R. He was a sweet guy, which is kind of important when you're trying to do a movie cheaply and not worrying about, the guy saying, I got to get home and I can't work today because I'm working as a court stenographer, which he was while he was going through this acting lessons and learning and doing things like that. It started as a school project. And Haig Nguyen, who was the head of the cinema department, saw a lot of promise in Marty, especially the way he directed. And there were some scenes in the original school version that stood out. There were scenes in it that were quite different than anything that they were shooting, especially in what they call the new wave style, but it didn't work. The story didn't quite gel. But in the meantime, he was doing other things, I was doing other things. We were doing things together trying to pay the bills. We were always doing something. Some of the things we did was, at that time, the film became a little bit more sexually, quote-unquote, liberated. So we wanted to do a movie called This Film Will Save Your Marriage, which is just sort of like one of those Swedish things where they use a lot of sex, but with the idea of it being educational. Of course, nothing happened to it. Always trying to do something. But, starving filmmaker syndrome, they call it. But the film was never forgotten, especially by people like Haig Nguyen. I think that's when some more money came in from God knows where to take that into make it into a feature film. And that's when it changed into I Call First.
First? What do you mean first? Who you call first? I call first. No, I know you call first. What do you want me to do?
So the story got a little bit more involved, a little more elaborate.
Did you read French?
No. With just a few words. They really should have an English version, though.
She was a fairly professional actress. She got paid, and I think she was in soap operas or something in New York. But the challenge basically was, if you're paying someone, you want to do the stuff as quick as possible.
Look at me. You go out with a guy and you don't even know what he's like. Let him take you out on some goddamn road and you don't mind it.
It's true.
What's true?
That became the quote-unquote, the hopefully released version. And then, if I remember, after that is 1969, when it was changed to Who's That Knocking on My Door? Joseph Brenner came into the picture. He paid to release it. However, he wanted a little more skin, a little more interesting. So Marty choreographed, storyboarded the scene, and it's a very sexual nudity added, but done in beautiful stylistic way. It was shot 4 years after the other parts were shot in Holland. You could actually see Harvey getting a little older. The way it was shot over the years, remember, things changed over the years. It depends on how much money, how big, you know, you were talking about minuscule budget or no budget, using your friends to do favors and things like that. So, and it looked more like a quote-unquote a home movie in the beginning, you know, than anything that you need street permits and things like that. Nobody took it seriously, and there was nobody with their hands out. You can't shoot here unless you pay us, because if you notice carefully, most of the scenes are in little corners of people's houses, his grandmother's, his own house, my own hallway, and the church in the neighborhood, and the small social club, and it was like two tables and a small bar, and that was it, like a bathroom, you know? It was so difficult to shoot because the space for the camera and the actors, and it was extremely difficult to do. Also, where you go to the grandmother's place to shoot a scene, and you only have a certain amount of time before she comes home and sees all the duct tapes on the walls and gets panicky. So you want to make sure you finish the shot before the grandmother shows up.
Yes, sir, it's WCAG here with 64 beautiful degrees out. Okay, now.
There wasn't that many street scenes. There was a couple of fight scenes in the street which were shot, you know, just going in, hey, okay, guys, let's do this and this and this. We have to stop sometimes because there are a lot of bums hanging around that neighborhood. And then one bum brings another bum, and before you know it, you got a whole bunch of them. And, you know, you kind of get rid of them somehow, or you go something different.
You can look at it if you want to.
No, that's all right. I was just looking.
The Staten Island Ferry scene was one of the first scenes, I think, with Zena. And to me, the most interesting scene was the scene in the station, was the important part of it, because that was the first time I saw Marty really do great stuff with the camera. He had that instinctive way of putting the camera where it should be to get the best out of the scene. That could be a boring scene if it was done in a two-shot, one-shot, one-shot. Yeah. But he used the whole area, moving it, dolling it, moving it. I always like to move the camera. That made the conversation more interesting.
And you pick up a couple of gas masks, and when you get halfway across the river, you put them on.
Money was always prepared, knew always what he wanted. He did not fool around. He was one of the first to believe what I say, which is paper is cheaper than film. Now, I think people watch it and they think it was all made up and done on the spur of the moment, you know. But it was very, very carefully thought out. And it was prepared, storyboarded. There is nothing in that film that was not intended.
No, huh? I call first.
You're the one who wants to watch the picture.
Anybody could call first.
I call first.
So Bobby, you want to choose?
I want to choose.
You want to choose? What about you?
The dialogue looked improvised, but it wasn't. About 80% of the time, it was all written out. And the reason why a lot of the dialogue works is because all these characters that we see in most of Marty's movies, especially the early ones, are real people. It's not only one person, but a combination of people. Each character is more than one person in real life. In a way, I think Harvey was the alter ego for Marty.
I'll tell you, Mr. Good Picture.
Sorry.
Oh, hey, there was this one scene in that movie that was a classic.
But not completely, you know. There are things in it that are a little differently. Marty is not exactly as confused as Harvey seems to be in these movies. Marty, in real life, was not a fighter or a troublemaker. He stayed away from that, and he was a terrific observer. So as far as an alter ego, maybe internally, a lot of it was, yes, definitely. Especially when it came to the church and religious influences. You know, Marty's very big on ritual, and you'll see the ritual in Who's That Knocking? And it's so clear that it kind of gives you where Marty's coming from. So Harvey and Marty are practically the same person there. The final version was the one that got the most attention. Film critics like Roger Ebert, who gave it a rave review in Chicago, I believe. And that led to other people taking it seriously. It's not a professional film because it was done cheaply. It was done over a long period of time, and it was done as the money came in and years ago went by and things were changed. I would say it started off as being amateur student thing and wound up being a very impressive professional film, but it'll never be what you call a clean masterpiece because that's not the way it was done. I learned a lot from what not to do, and Marty learned a lot from what not to do. And whatever is in there is more interesting because of its imperfection, and you see the steps you have to go through, and this is an early step that was taken to be a director by learning from the fact that you make mistakes, you know, and you do things a little bit rougher, not as polished as in the early stages, and you grow from it.